This episode of Popcorn Poops is brought to you by Audible.com. Please visit audibletrial.com/popcornpoops for a 30-day trial of their audiobook subscription service. When you sign up, you'll even receive a free audiobook that's yours to keep whether or not you continue with Audible after your trial has expired. That's audibletrial.com/popcornpoops for your free audiobook.
We are the Popcorn Poops.
Welcome to Popcorn Poops, the best married couple movie podcast / commentary track hybrid audio program on the internet. My name is Dustin, and with me, as always and per usual, is my wife, Jessiquita.
Thank you.
How are you?
I'm good. How are you?
I'm doing very well. Do you have a? I think that you have a thing coming up that we should talk about, because that's important when we have things.
I do have a thing.
We have things and stuff. Up. Specifically, you have a speaking engagement.
Yeah, this weekend I'm presenting. My paper was accepted at the Tennessee Philological Association's annual conference. So I'm going to do that academic conference thing and going to talk to some academics about Marxism in John Carpenter's The Thing.
Which is a thing. See what I did there? That we did on the podcast. So you've probably heard a lot of her talking points already.
Most of them, probably.
But if you want to see her present them in person.
And really, like, don't. I mean, if you haven't been to an academic conference before, then people really are just reading papers. So
it really
so
is just like
present.
That.
Present is a very. Maybe.
Do you have a PowerPoint?
Animated? No.
No PowerPoint.
No, you just read the papers.
It's very simple. Stripped down. Raw. Some might say raw.
And Q&A. There's Q&A.
And Q&A. Oh, well, you can ask some questions. That'd be great. That'd be great if we had a Popcorn Poops listener there who asked a question about the podcast, and all the academics would be like, harumph. Harumph and hooray to this. Not hooray. I don't know. What do they say? Harumph and something else. What do academics say when they're flustered?
What did they say when they're flustered?
Besides harumph.
Fuck. They say fuck.
Oh, okay. The most intelligent of words. Harumph and fuck. What the fuck are you doing here, Popcorn Poops listeners? So let's get a strong showing of one or two out there to support you. I'll be there, of course, watching you present. That'll be fun. So if you are in and around the Clarksville, Tennessee area this Saturday, you will be presenting. What time are you going on?
I don't actually have the time with me, but it's in the morning.
It's in the morning. So watch her Twitter feed, which we'll get to in a minute, and I'm sure she'll post it at some point. If you want to come out and, you know, meet us and see her speak, because that'll be kind of fun. As always, you can find us on our website at popcornpoops.com. You can follow us on iTunes and Stitcher. That's where you can subscribe to the show. And of course, there's other places where you can get it, other podcatchers and podcast apps and platforms. You can follow us on Twitter and Facebook. Our Twitter handle is at Popcorn Poops. And then we have individual Twitter handles. Of course, I am at Dusty Cram Cram.
I'm at J. Casper Kramer.
And our social media is basically where you can stay up to date with all of the updates about the show, including our weekly movie still identification game. It's a fun little game we like to play with our listeners. Check out our social media for that. We also have a shop where you can buy some stuff, the same stuff that you could buy for the last 3 weeks that it's been open. T-shirts, tote bags, buttons. I've fallen down on the job a little bit, but those things are still there if you want to purchase them. If you're not into purchasing things but would rather just hand over your hard-earned cash to perfect strangers, we do have a donate button on the website. If that's a thing that you're into, that would also be just fine. This month, our theme is hashtag VG month, which stands for video games.
Yes.
And not venereal gonorrhea.
Mm-hmm.
So just to clear that up. And we're wrapping up this month. Last episode, it's kind of sad. I miss it already. We are wrapping up this month with the mother of all video game as plot centric movies, Todd Holland's 1989 film The Wizard, starring Fred Savage, and he is a savage. We're going to see that in this movie. If you want to sync up this movie to the podcast that you're listening to right now, as you can do with all of our episodes, you're going to want to go ahead and play the movie and then press pause as soon as the title card reading a Finnegan Pinchuk Company production completely fades away into the dusty desert road that you should be seeing on your screen. And while you're setting that up, I believe Jessica has a review that we received. iTunes?
This review comes from iTunes. It is from Henrik Og Joachim. And the title is Amazing, Love It, Super Fun. And the review states, love this podcast.
Great.
So fantastic. Great. By the way, it's 5 stars.
Of course. Of course it is. Brevity is the soul of 5-star reviews.
And so much more powerful with those five stars behind it. They are.
My favorite part was that the body of the review was shorter than the subject line.
True.
That was my favorite part.
That was a thing.
Also, the five stars. Yeah, I really like that.
Also.
If you want to leave us a five-star review or other star review on iTunes or Stitcher, we will read it on the show. So just imagine the possibilities. You can, mm-hmm. I mean, you could leave us five stars, and I think you'd owe it to us if you wrote something really crazy, but you could make us say anything.
It's true.
You really could. Just the possibilities are endless, you know? You could even make us try to speak another language. How the fuck's that going to go? Probably really terribly.
Probably.
And hilariously. So, I mean, it's in your hands, dear pooplings. So go and leave us a review. If you're ready, we're going to start the movie. Are you ready?
Oh, yeah.
You ready for the wizard?
I'm ready
for the wizard. All right, sinkers, press play at the beep after the countdown. Ready? 3, 2, 1. Oh, listen to that wonderful, the dulcet tones of the Bodines. The Bodines, which is, this is a song called You Don't Get Much. I've never heard it before watching this movie, which should tell you everything you need to know about You Don't Get Much by the Bodines.
I wish we got less of this song.
We get a couple of songs. We get a couple of nice upbeat 80s tunes throughout this mm-hmm. flim.
During the multiple montages to enjoy.
Definitely more than one. I mean, it is an 80s film. You know, 89, they're finishing off the year with a bang. Much like Fred Savage did. This is one of two movies that were released starring Fred Savage this year, the other being Little Monsters. So 1989, 2 for 2 on terrible fucking children's movies. Fred Savage.
Wow. Good job.
Good job. Wonder Year, of course, like he became famous for the Wonder Years, and he's had a fine middling career ever since.
You did a Wonder Years thing for a while.
Before we knew each other, I did more than a Wonder Years thing for a while. I was way on board.
Before we knew each other was a pretty long time ago.
Yes. But yeah, I was really into the Wonder Years. Really into Winnie Cooper.
Okay.
And I think that a lot of people my age were. If you were into Winnie Cooper, shout out on our social media and try not to be creepy about it.
I don't know.
Less than or equal totally to possible. Creepy as I am talking about basically a child. She was a child for most of that show. So fuck, I'm digging a hole here. So please help me.
I'm not helping you. You keep on digging.
Okay, so in this opening scene right here, we have our main character, the titular character, the eponymous wizard, played by Luke Edwards, who went on to be in Little Big League.
I think I was randomly looking on IMDb and I found him, and I think he's hot now.
Is he hot now?
I think so.
Okay.
I didn't like fact check to make sure I was looking at the right person, but I was scrolling and I'm pretty sure that's who I came up on, and I think he's hot now. I think he's 29.
I'm looking at him. He's 35.
Oh, yeah. Okay. Then it was the wrong picture.
He's hot.
Let me see.
Yeah, he's hot.
Oh my.
He's a child here. Look at the screen. Look at the screen.
I'm not looking at this. I'm looking at your screen over there.
Center yourself. Look at the screen. He's a child here. Okay. Like, I know Dan, what's her name? Whoever played Winnie Cooper. I'm not going to look it up. I can't remember her name. I wanted to say Danica Patrick, but it's not Danica Patrick. It's someone else.
Danica Patrick.
She's a race car driver.
I know.
I don't know. I feel like her name is like Danica something. Fuck, I wish I had that in my notes right now.
Oh, my God.
I didn't expect to talk about the fucking Wonder Years so much. So he was walking along this highway, and he stopped by a police officer. And the vehicle here, you can see it says right there, Farley County.
Mm-hmm.
Farley County is a fictional location, which sets us off right away with a fucking terrible lie. This movie is just a series of lies.
Oh, yeah. It's just big
starting
lies.
Man, with what Farley was County.
So, like, they had the airplane, right? That I'm guessing it's a crop duster or something like that. Whatever.
Sure.
Whatever. I don't know. It's like a small... Do they crop dust out there? Do they have crops in the desert?
Yes.
This is how much I know about the world.
That's not what my research was focused on.
Not on crop dusting.
No.
Anyways, it's like some little personal plane. And I guess they just spent so much money on that plane that they had to have at least two shots with the plane. Like, there's the scene where Jimmy's walking. They've got the plane that goes to find. Why? Why do they need a plane to go find the kid? But then when the cop shows up, they show the plane again as though, like, the plane had to lead the cop to the kid.
Yeah.
It's just like, okay, well, get your money's worth out of this plane, I guess.
The first thing the first thing that we hear, like the first line of dialogue, is something about like Putnam was right, he'd be walking along, or the whatever it was, which is a writing technique that this film uses, if you want to call it a technique. It's probably the film's favorite technique in that it thinks it's good writing when you talk about something that the audience doesn't know fuck all about.
Oh my God.
And then you explain what the thing was that you were talking about later, and it's like,
and by that point, oh, the viewers are so confused already.
Holy shit. You talk about overwritten. This movie is overwritten to hell and
God.
Back. It's ridiculous.
So like, just a great intro to that, when the cop picks up Jimmy on the side of the road. Cop picks up Jimmy, and someone over the intercom says to him, take him to his mother's
radio.
The radio, sorry. Okay. Says, take him to his mother's place. She's remarried. And you're like, why are you giving me that information?
Why is that important?
Through the cop radio.
So it makes me feel like there's a closeness with the police department that I immediately sense. I'm trying to read into this. So the cop says over the radio, take him to his mother. She's remarried now. Okay, that insinuates that the mother does not have custody of him, and maybe that this remarriage was very recent, and also she's close enough to the police department in some capacity.
That they're talking about this over the radio, and that maybe people wouldn't know yet.
Right.
So maybe she's married to a cop where she was?
Sure. So then they cut to a scene where he's like playing with blocks on the other side of like a mirror, Jimmy. And they're talking to a child psychologist and his mother and I guess his stepdad. Mm-hmm. That's what we've come to learn. But at the time we don't know this. So we're just like, and the dad says something about, I've got the cops running all over the neighborhood or all over the county. And it's just like, okay, so this dad is a higher level management type in the police department who's sending his department out to look for his stepson all over the place. And he's bitter about it, but that's not the case. He's not a cop. So then we cut to Beau Bridges here, who's raising his other two sons, one of which is played by Fred Savage, the other by Christian Slater, Corey and Nick, respectively. And then you're like, okay, so he's the cop. He must be the cop.
Right. He even says a couple things like, that's a direct order, boys, and things like that.
And you're like, okay.
We're using like military, you know, rhetoric. Authoritative, yeah. Right? Like, yeah, okay, okay. So sure. This is the cop, Carrie. This one's definitely the cop.
Definitely the cop. No one's the cop.
No, there's no.
So like that, the first one of the first lines in the movie, it's like, take him to his mother. She's remarried now. Insinuates a closeness with the police department that they don't actually have. No one's in the police department.
These police at this police department are just talking about people, random regulars out on the street, random normies.
Did I tell you the last time I was at Geek Media Expo in Nashville, and I was talking about the people that were walking into the hotel that it was held at. It was held at the Music City Sheraton. And I was just like, I wonder what those people think of all these crazies dressed up in like clothes. I wonder what the normies think about us. And I was corrected by some stranger who was like, they're called mundanes.
Oh my God.
I'm like I was scared for a second. I was like, did I say something like
offensive
or not politically correct or something like that? But what?
Mundanes.
They're called mundanes.
Like they're a species in a fantasy book.
Oh shit, Jesus Christ. But anyway. Yeah, so this movie just starts on a bad foot. The kid goes on and on about like California. Jimmy's like, California, California. That's basically his only line of dialogue in the movie. He says a little bit more than that.
At the end he says a couple more things.
Yeah, but mostly his paycheck was for saying California over
and wearing
and over
a hat
again.
That was slightly too big for him, which was kind of cute.
A little bit cute.
But yeah, so then we had this whole thing with the dad, the real dad, not the stepdad.
Right, Beau Bridges.
And
yes.
And he's sitting at the table with Fred Savage and Christian Slater. And I don't know, we're supposed to, I guess, get the impression that he's a mess up dad and the kids are losing their way or something.
Something like he doesn't seem to have it all together because he's trying to cook, but he can't cook anything because he's a single dad that can't cook. Wah, wah, wah.
And then like we cut away to this scene where Nick is the older brother, Christian Slater.
Yes, Christian Slater's character.
So Nick, we hear Nick and the dad through a window screaming at each other about Nick drinking alcohol and stealing the car.
Yes.
And so about making, their dead mom.
Yes. Yes. He says something about like, if mom were still alive, etc.
And alcohol, blah, blah, blah. And they really try to, for that 5 seconds, paint Nick as like a screw up teenager. Right. And then they just don't try ever again.
No.
But they refer to it repeatedly about how he's a mess up.
Keep referring back to it. But like as soon as they have a shared goal of getting Corey and Jimmy back, who have decided to run away because Jimmy has been put in a, and this is their word, not mine, a home, air quotes, because he keeps running away and he's, as the child psychologist says, severely traumatized. I don't know anything about child psychology, but I would imagine that this is a treasure trove of terrible.
This movie as a whole?
Yes, in general.
Oh my God, this movie as a whole.
They never actually say what his disorder is, like what exactly is wrong with him, but it's kind of implied to be autism.
Mm-hmm. Well, and like he says savant too.
Yeah, the word savant is thrown in there. So it's implied to be autism, but later there's a revelation
later. Find there's actually nothing wrong with Jimmy.
Right, because it's there's just, a cause
it's
behind.
It's just the screwed up family he's from.
Right. You actually mentioned that there's moments in this movie that kind of feel like Rain Man.
Oh, yeah.
Rain Man for kids. And I think that they probably intentionally steered away from using the A word because Rain Man had come out just the year before this.
So we'll talk about all that later. But really, we need to pay attention to this scene right now and how there is no way in any universe that adults would act this way about children. Or at least not any universe that I want to be a part of.
Yeah.
I guess there are universes where people would act this way about children. And do much worse things. But we've got these adults all in this room talking about Jimmy and Corey who have run away together.
Mm-hmm.
And Jimmy runs away.
The little line he just said. I know you're about to say it.
I don't know which
he
one
said,
was it.
He said, you know, he says he's going to go out and get Jimmy. And Beau Bridges is like, well, what about Corey? And he's like, I mean, even if we brought him back, would it do any good?
Well, Corey wants to run away, doesn't he?
Oh, Jesus.
If we brought him back, would it do any good?
So you're talking about...
No, he's still also 10 years old. No, I think he's 13.
So the parent, these are the parents that put Jimmy in a home because he's quiet and runs away a lot trying to go to California. So they just stick him in like a mental home for kids. And then when he runs away again with Corey.
And it's not very aggressive running away. It's like get your lunchbox and slowly walk down the street to California.
Like that's it. He just has the lunchbox, and even the dad's like, he just picks up his lunchbox. What's in that damn thing?
And I'm like, why don't you open
it? Yeah, you live with it. Open the fucking
adult
lunchbox, you idiot. What's wrong with you? And you know, of course, in that scene we're introduced to the Mr. Putnam right here, who is who's the child bounty hunter. Played by Will Seltzer.
That's correct.
He is a child bounty hunter. It's kind of got a Raising Arizona feel to it with the hiring of the bounty hunter to get the child back. Although he's much less dangerous than the bounty hunter in Raising Arizona is presented to be. So yeah, right off the bat, it's just like these adults in this movie fucking suck. And they continue to make terrible, shitty, childish decisions all the way through this movie.
I mean, they have this whole conversation in there with the child bounty hunter and it's very confusing. I want to say mom, but she's actually a stepmom to Corey and Nick.
Yes,
but she's
that's
the
right.
real mom. Let's just.
But
it
that's
took
never
us,
clear. Oh my
it
God.
Took us a,
it took a until while. The info dump about like halfway through this movie to figure out what all of the familial connections.
Who are all of these characters? Oh my God. It's so confusing for no reason.
Yeah, it does. None of it
There's
makes sense.
There's no reason. It's And it is
well,
so confusing.
And part of
confusing.
It is like the technique, the quote unquote writing technique that I'd talked about before, where you introduce something like the first line of the movie, they're talking about Putnam. Who the fuck is Putnam?
It's really,
then
you
we
know,
find out three scenes later, oh, Putnam is a bounty hunter. Okay, glad that's clear.
You using the word writing technique with what they're doing in this movie is like using the word writing technique when someone misspells something. it's about the same.
It's called creative liberty. It's called literary
intentionally
license.
Misspells intentional is very. Yes. I mean,
yes, it's a very Rudy toot toot.
Anyways, so back to that scene. We've got these parents standing in there. The mom, who's stepmom to Corey and Nick, but she's the real mom of Jimmy and the dad of all of the kids. And then the stepdad to only Jimmy, I guess. How does that work? I'm very confused.
Okay, so, and this is, we don't find this out till much later, but Christine, who is the mother, is the second wife of Beau Bridges. So Beau Bridges was married before to a woman we never see because she died. With that woman, he had Corey, played by Fred Savage, and Nick, played by Christian Slater. When she died, he married Christine. With Christine, he had Jimmy. Okay. Then Christine and Beau Bridges' character divorced. And then Christine married this other dude that's
the stepdad.
The stepdad.
So they're all in this room together.
Played by Sam McMurray.
They're all in this room together and they're discussing how they've hired this guy Putnam to go get Jimmy back, but not to get Corey back.
Yes.
And it's
that is definitely the discussion.
It is unbelievable because I'm like, whether or not Corey is her biological child, she lived with him as her legal child.
Yes.
For at least the length of Jimmy's life, almost up until now, because of some pictures we see. And I think Jimmy's what, 8?
Right.
He's supposed to be. Both these kids look younger than their ages say they are. But for 8 years, Corey was her child and Nick too. And she's saying that she's not going to let this bounty hunter also get Corey. She only wants him to bring back Jimmy. Like, are we paying per child, I guess? And my whole thing is imagining, I'm trying to picture what it looks like to find one child when two children are walking together down the road and put one in your car and just leave the other one there on the side of the road.
It's like, no, you
because
want
that's what
you
they're
want,
implying.
You want to run away, right? What good is it going to do if we bring you back? That's a line.
But he Jimmy line. Wants to run away but, repeatedly, yes,
Jimmy,
way more than Corey.
Oh, yeah. Corey only does because he's tired of, well, he wants to break Jimmy out, and he's deciding where he's going to run away to, and his dad and Nick are fighting, so he throws darts at this map, and then it lands on California, which is something I'm definitely sure he's heard Jimmy say, and he's like, oh, California. All right, let's do it.
Yeah, we just randomly come to that, okay, yeah, we're going to walk to California.
And that dart lands right the fuck on Los Angeles.
And it's
California's
not even...
California's a big state.
Oh, yeah.
We all know this. California's a big state. He lands right the motherfuck on Los Angeles.
And, like, there's not even a reason for California. Like, Jimmy has a reason. It has to do with being a kid and thinking that one place in California is California and whatever. But there's actually not a reason for them to go to California until another 20 minutes later from where we are now or something like that.
Right, of course.
Because eventually they go to the video game competition. But
Corey's motive is simply to run away. And California is the destination because he literally threw a dart at a map. And
right.
It just kind of coincided
well,
with Jimmy's.
Well, he threw three darts and he didn't like the first two because who wants to go to Arkansas, I guess?
Sure, yeah.
I mean, that was the face he made.
It's reasonable.
And then the third dart landed on California. He's like, California.
Yeah, so he goes and breaks Jimmy out, and they're on their way.
And Jimmy,
I guess,
says, California. And he's like, yay, California.
God, when he breaks him out, there's like, it's a cold, sterile, old, like mental style hospital that's white walls out, built out of like an old house, of course. And there's one sign on Jimmy's wall that says, learn to relax.
What?
That's all. There's just a sign like above the desk on Jimmy's wall inside the hospital that says "Learn to relax." And what the fuck?
Oh my God!
What is up with that? They're like, "This'll help.
This'll help.
This is medicine. This is medical science right here."
Also, I love that the kid's logic of running away to a specific location is to just pick the first truck you see going anywhere and get inside, and then that's going to take somewhere. And that will be the specific location you want to go
to. They jump inside a Hostess snacks truck. And
that's what they're feeding the kids at the hospital, too. I just realized
coincidence.
That.
How about that? Because it's at the hospital.
Yeah.
It's like, no, that's not...
Unloading a truck full of Hostess cakes.
Well, the hospital is to help their mental health, not their physical health.
Oh, okay. So it's actually let that body go to waste.
Yeah, it's actually a feeder hospital for the fat camp. That's how that works.
So you go here first.
Right,
and then
you go
the
here,
next one.
And then you go see Ben Stiller at Heavyweights.
Okay, got
everything's
it.
A-okay. But yeah, so Corey convinces Jimmy to get in the back of the truck by simply saying, do you like chocolate? Which is how I get all children into my van. I don't know about
you. He learns young.
But that's the line I use. Yeah. Oh, yeah. Well, that's it. I mean, he's a pro already.
Yeah. And then just the whole attitude of Putnam, of the kid catcher.
Yeah. The bounty hunter with a bolo tie. Bolo ties mean business.
Here's a quote from him. I make money by bringing kids in, and I don't make it if someone brings them in first, if you catch my drift, so let's not be getting in my way. Really? Someone whose living is made by conceivably rescuing children. That's what he does, is rescue children. But he doesn't care about children at all.
Right. How about fuck you, bounty hunter? I'm his father, and I'll find him if I want to. How about that?
Well, and I mean, that's what the characters do.
Well, exactly.
But for me, it's just really hard to picture someone who's done that with their life. Like, I know people think it's fun to just make characters evil characters for the hell of it or whatever, but this is something he's chosen to do with his life. And there's probably a lot more failure than success, and there's probably actually not a lot of money in a job like this. So it's really hard to picture a sleazebag who absolutely doesn't care about children at all doing a job like this. It's very contrived. It's very movie feeling in the worst way.
Yeah, of course. Okay, we've got Jenny Lewis. We totally missed the entire scene at the bus stop where lots of things happened that we totally missed. And, you know, we're how many minutes into this? Less than half an hour into this thing. And we've already got references to Dairy Queen, Hostess Snacks, Sinclair Oil Corporation, all sponsors of this 96-minute commercial. All of these product placements very present in the film. And, of course, Jimmy plays an arcade version of, it's not the arcade version, but he plays an arcade cabinet with the console version of Double Dragon, which does make sense because he's playing a PlayChoice 10, which was an arcade cabinet containing 10 NES games that you could choose from. So even though it's not the arcade version of Double Dragon, it's still accurate to the time because it's a PlayChoice 10 cabinet. Does that make sense?
Sure.
Okay. Glad you're paying attention.
I mean, I was definitely in 89, you know, playing cabinets, so.
And Jimmy gets a score of like 50,000 points in Double Dragon, which is pretty high. The high score currently is like 90,000 something points. Currently, like right now, the high score in Double Dragon for NES is 90,000 points, so not bad. But Jenny Lewis is a terrible person. She's a habitual gambler, and just an awful reprobate, just the worst kind of person.
We're talking about the little girl?
Yes. Well, I mean, one of the first things she says to Jimmy, without even knowing him, he hasn't said word one to him. She doesn't know him from Adam. Never seen him before in her life. She looks at him for like 2 seconds and says, what's his problem?
Oh, yeah.
And Fred Savage is like, oh, he's just shy. And she says, shy a few bricks, I'd say.
How has she made that assessment?
That fucking escalated so quickly.
Jimmy hasn't even spoken, and she hasn't been around them at all. So it's not like she can take his not speaking to be strange.
I do like how Beau Bridges is beating the shit out of this bounty hunter's car, because it just makes me think of the Big Lebowski. This is what happens when you fuck a stranger in the ass.
True. But I really could do without the bumpin' funny time hillbilly music.
Rim dim diggle ding diggle ding.
Like, I mean, you're joking, but that's actually pretty accurate.
Yeah, the score to this movie is not the greatest. I kind of prefer the upbeat 80s tunes.
Oh, yeah.
Then
the score. I didn't even look up who did the score for this. That's how little it mattered to me.
I didn't even think about it. Beau Bridges being the brother of Jeff Bridges.
Oh.
Who was in the Big Lebowski that I just referenced in the beating up the car scene.
But yeah, they do that a few times where they have Putnam, the child catcher, and...
Every time you say child, I assume you're going to follow it with rapist or something. I just assume. Putnam the child... Because, come on. Putnam the child, fill in the blank. Let's play Mad Libs with it. Realistically, where's
him
your head
going? And the father... have multiple scenes where they just attack each other and bash each other's cars, because that's the fastest way to save children who are alone traveling the highways without adult supervision. There are three children here between the ages of 8 and 13 who are traveling by themselves by hitchhiking.
Yes.
And the priority is let's slit each other's tires and bash each other's windshields in instead of finding the children. And also no one else in the world cares.
No. And you know, you've got this scene right here where they've got these farmers who see the kids stowed away in the back of their truck, counting money that they've acquired from trading in her bus ticket and just the $27. They have like a grand total of $114.
Maybe.
And these grown men steal this money. This is what they're doing right now. They steal this money.
$114. It's kind of a terrifying scene, actually.
Yeah. If it didn't have like the really, you know,
well, the same, hillbilly the bumping, music, the bumping funny time hillbilly.
Yeah, it would be terrifying. It is terrifying, actually.
It is terrifying. They pull the children out of the back of their truck and steal are kind of money, manhandling them.
Steal their money and leave them to die on the side of the road.
In the desert.
In the fucking desert. What?
There are no adults in this movie, apparently. Apparently, there are just like in the whole world, in the whole universe of this movie, because no one stops and sees these three children on the side of the road in the desert and gives them a ride to the police station.
I don't know.
What?
I wanted to say about back at the bus station when Jimmy's playing Double Dragon and shit's going down because he's they've got a bet going with what's her name? Haley? Jenny Lewis's character, Haley. They've got a bet going with her that he can't, you know, beat her score in Double Dragon, and he totally does. And while he's playing, the music rises.
Oh man, the guy behind the counter,
the cashier, the bus station attendant, like looks over the counter like he knows like, some what? Shit's going
What's
down.
What's going on over there?
What's this?
Man, I can just in the air, I can just smell
50,000 points. Someone's in getting 50,000 points. My dick's so hard right now. Anyway.
Also, the ticket from Utah to California was $113 per person by bus.
Jesus, yeah.
And I was like, man, that's kind of high for 89.
Yeah.
And I looked it up, and I'm not wrong, because today you can get a bus ticket from Salt Lake City to LA for about $80 a person.
What the hell? What is that about? What's with the inflated prices? The wizard?
So I don't know. It just struck me kind of strange. It
takes place in an alternate reality where shit just costs more. The cafe they went to. They went to a cafe across the street from the bus station.
Oh, that you
want to
go to?
Where they've got arcades built into tables. What the hell is that? I want to go there.
I've seen that stuff before. I've been to some restaurants that have done that.
And Jenny Lewis refers to video game people video heads. And that, 1989, you're fucking adorable.
Also, what is this world where old salesmen take their lunch breaks to go play video games in a restaurant and then gamble with small children?
Yeah, well, that's another example of how the adults in this movie act like terrible children, and the kids don't act like fucking kids. They don't. None
the
of them
do. The only thing that shows them acting like kids is in the scene that's about to come up, I think, where they take stuff out of their bags that they've packed and they have completely useless stuff inside their bags.
Yes, that's the only thing that makes them act like kids. Actually, Chris French on Facebook notes that none of the kids, like I said, act like kids except for Jimmy, who does act like a kid. Only probably because he's a terrible actor.
It's okay. He grew up to be hot.
And that's all that matters, really, in this world. But yeah, all of these adults are terrible children. And all of the children are precocious and talk like they're in a fucking noir movie, especially Jenny Lewis. Mm-hmm. What was it that she said about her mom being a showgirl or something
like
that?
Did she miss that already?
This is the line. She goes, "My mom, she packed it in. She was a showgirl, had great legs."
No, just great legs. Don't even add the hat.
Oh, okay. "She was a showgirl. Great legs. I've got great legs, too." Doesn't she say
no.
right?
Does she say I've got great legs,
yes.
too?
Yes.
Oh, my God. I didn't even catch that part.
She
I was
does.
Still stuck on the part before it.
Gee, I wonder if a man wrote this. I wonder if a man
no
wrote
way.
This movie.
No way. Not even. Who talks? What the hell does "she packed it in" even mean? Is that a euphemism for died?
She died? Because she has no parents in this movie. Her world has no parental figures in it whatsoever.
So we just saw them empty their bags and they had like masks and
giant spiders
giant plastic
and rubber
spiders.
Masks
and I'm like, no, yeah, this
flashlights.
Is
okay.
Yeah, this is yep. Mm-hmm.
That's how a kid
like
packs.
when I first saw Corey take out the giant spider out of his bag, I was like, what the hell? Where did they get that from? And then he takes out the mask and then I'm like, oh, okay, yeah. Yeah.
Yes.
That's about right.
Got it.
That's about what a child would pack. But he's 13 though. Mm. He's supposed to be 13.
Yeah. Well, that's fine. It's 89. I think that the universal state of arrested development that young people are have kind of suffered from had already started at that point.
I don't know.
I guess, we're talking about a movie that's about video games.
I guess I just I feel like, I mean, I can believe Haley's 13, but Corey and Jimmy feel so much younger to me than 13 and 8. They feel so much younger.
They did. I feel like, you know, this movie is, of course, touted as a 96-minute long commercial for Nintendo and Super Mario Brothers, but I feel like it's kind of a bad commercial for Nintendo. The first time we see an actual NES in the movie, we just saw it a couple scenes ago. Christian Slater's playing it in the repair shop where they've got their truck. Is that right?
Oh, this is a montage, by the way. We're in a traveling montage.
"Send Me an Angel" by Real Life. Oh yeah, that's an upbeat 80s tune that I want to hear right now. Right on time.
Oh,
hits
God.
The spot. The first NES that we see in the movie that Christian Slater's playing in that in the repair shop that they go to, he has to fix. He mentions he's just like, "I found his old video game machine. I fixed it, and you know I'm playing it now." And Bo Bridges is like, "You fixed that thing?" It's like, no. If it's a commercial for your product,
you don't show it broken.
You don't insinuate that it was ever broken. That thing is an immortal god of the ages as far as your product goes and its sellability.
Mm-hmm. Right. Yeah. You start talking about how you got to, you know, blow into the cartridges and shit. You're not really going to win a lot of new purchases.
This kid right here, the not Fred Savage and Luke Edwards.
He has some Fred Savage hair.
Holy shit. He is an impressive Fred Savage lookalike.
Mm-hmm.
I hope that he capitalized on a career with that. I hope that he did. Hope he took that dream, grabbed at that dream and took it and rode it like a bull.
Oh, God.
But another reason why it's a terrible commercial for Nintendo is when they challenge when they're hustling the businessmen and they challenge the salesman in the cafe to, you know, out of more money because Jimmy's a wizard and he's really good at video games and that's what they're doing because they're all just, I mean, they're gamblers. That's all they are. They're just gambling their way across the country. they don't actually show them playing video games. They don't take that opportunity to show you more, you know, on screen, like full screen footage of a video game being played. It just cuts to them counting their money. So you're a terrible fucking commercial for Nintendo.
Also,
movie that's a commercial for Nintendo.
Roger Ebert, when this movie came out, he was not given a lot of praise. Surprisingly,
I'm shocked.
And there were some fights on like the back pages and the talk pages in Wikipedia, right? About stuff that the Wikipedia article says. Actually, I looked it up and it's true. Roger Ebert does point out that there's a lot of misnaming in this movie in terms of the video games.
Do you see
games.
Who it is? It's Sometimes I Doubt Your Commitment to Sparkle Motion. I love her so much. Nice cameo. I'm going to look up her name because she deserves credit.
He mentions that there's misnaming of stuff in this movie, like game-wise.
Beth Grant. Beth Grant represent.
There's a scene where someone says something. I think it's Nick who says it, maybe, who says that he's on Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles level 3, and then it cuts to a shot of him playing level 1.
Yes.
And but there's a lot of that did, in this movie.
He did refer to the Mecha Turtle at the end of level 3, which is true. There is a Mecha Turtle at the end of level 3.
So maybe he just died and got set back.
Right.
Whatever. But the point is that there's a lot of that in this movie. There are multiple. They do it with Double Dragon. They do it with during the Super Mario 3 tournament. There's a lot of that. And people were like, they argue. There are a lot of people on the internet that defend this movie super, super fucking hard.
Why?
I don't know.
I mean, okay. The movie's overwritten and it's bad and it's got bad performances and the music is terrible. But
you get a butt after that one?
It's a kind of competent road trip movie.
Yeah.
Like, it has a very clear beginning, middle, and end with development for our protagonists and a goal and motivations. And that really, like, it's terrible. But that basic shit that a movie needs, this is a movie.
I guess. I just,
you know what, like, you know what I mean?
I just
mean?
Don't think it's very fun. I just don't think it's fun. I think it's really overly complicated.
I
don't like many of the characters. I really don't like Haley. No, she's not a likable character.
I didn't say that they were likable. I just said that they were characters.
True. And I don't know. It just I know like all the old school references in here are great, and that's fun. I mean, we're in the famous Power Glove scene right now, which is
hilarious.
Hilarious and probably the most memorable thing in this movie.
Yeah. I mean, we do get a lot of like nice footage of actual video games being played full screen. Like we see like they don't shy away from it. It shows how video games are actually played more or less. They show games like Double Dragon, Ninja Gaiden, Super Mario Brothers 2, Top Speed, and we just saw him play Rad Racer with the Power Glove. And it's a shame that the Power Glove never fucking worked that well. And if he's actually using the Power Glove and doing that well with the Power Glove, then Lucas is a for real wizard with black magic and sorcery. Like for real.
Like an actual wizard.
Like an actual wizard. He's not using it, it's just magic because the Power Glove fucking sucked. It didn't work. But he loves the Power Glove. It's so bad.
It's so bad. Yeah, so
and then like after he says that, you know, after he finishes, you know, beating, or he doesn't beat Lucas's score, or not Lucas. Lucas is the badass kid. He doesn't beat Jimmy's score.
Jimmy doesn't play.
Jimmy walks away, right? And after Jimmy walks away, he says, "By the way, I'm entered into the championships too," followed by a tiny smile like he just released a silent, satisfying fart. I know that smile.
I know you do.
Oh, when he pushes the buttons on his Power Glove, it's a nice little close encounter.
Oh, that's right,
reference.
Yeah.
It's kind of tipping their hand a little. Hey, movie? Kinda,
yeah, a little bit.
Kind of wish you were Spielberg.
Wishing you were...
Spielberg movie?
Different kind of movie made by a different kind of person?
Maybe you should do a Spielberg movie? Was this directed by Tobe Hooper?
Oh no. You just made a joke Toby. About Toby Hooper. Oh. Yeah, but my point is that I don't think that all the cute little references to these games and stuff are enough for this to be a cult movie for me. You talk about cult kids movies from the 80s for me, like The Gate, right?
Sure.
That's a fantastic watch. That's a movie I would watch right now.
It's after a fantastic we bad movie.
Yeah, that's what I'm talking about. Yeah. When I say cult movies, that's usually I'm usually talking
about bad
movies.
It's like Monster Squad. We watched Monster Squad recently, and I. But I can see it. Like, right. I get it.
Yeah.
I don't know. I don't know why, but like it struck me as really bothersome when Dracula picks up the little girl and just screams at her and says something about her being a bitch, like right to her face.
Yeah, that was intense.
I'm just like, what the fuck?
Yeah, but this movie does some of that shit too.
This movie does do a little bit of that. I mean, we're talking about a PG movie in the 80s where shit was everybody's favorite word. Like they could say shit this and shit that and shit on your mom and shit on your dog and your cat and your brother and shitting shits and holy shits and butts and all, no fucks, but shits for days. I mean, that was the bread and butter of an 80s children, quote unquote, children's movie, because for whatever reason, kids movies back in the day had to have a bunch of like cursing in them.
I had to have kids cursing.
Kids
too.
Cursing, which used to be shit. Like you could get away with shit in a kids movie. Now you can't really. Like you can say shit on TV now, but it's not appropriate for anything like kids related.
Yeah. You aren't going to see Wreck-It Ralph dropping a shit bomb.
That would be awesome.
But anyways, what I'm saying though is I don't think it's enough to carry. It doesn't stand up for me as so bad it's good. And it's so bad that it's not enjoyable to me is right. How I feel in the end. And the stuff with the gaming in it is just not, it's just not enough for me. I don't know. Maybe I mean, if I had seen it when I was a kid, then maybe I would have some nostalgic feeling for it. But I didn't, so I don't.
I feel like it's the most genuine, one of the most genuine portrayals of gaming or showing like video gaming in a movie.
Wait, what part's genuine? The part where the kid's a savant at it or the part where he goes to a gaming tournament and
I don't know.
wins a ton of money?
I don't know. Like it's such a
this
simple.
This is genuine, I think.
Yeah, it's such a simple thing to say, but it's like showing people playing actual games that actually exist.
Okay, yeah.
You know, with
Well, and like the douchebag kid who has them all in the case and is like, I've got 97 games.
I've got all 97.
All 90. Like, what is all 97 mean?
I don't know what that means because there were like 600 or something officially released NES games, not including like the unofficially released
stuff. Yeah, I didn't look it up to see what was out in 89 specifically, but I was like, 97?
Yeah,
really?
It's a little shy of, you know.
All 97. And then the thing is that Jimmy and Haley and Corey, they base all of Jimmy's training off of what Lucas had. They're like, okay, we've got to get these 97 games down.
These
and I'm
specific
like,
specific 97 games.
I'm like, why these 97 games? And I love how he does all this training and then he only plays two games in the tournament.
Oh my God. So Jimmy has this thing where he stacks stuff. Like that they never explain. Like it's this fixation that he has with stacking stuff. Like he wants
right because they're trying to make it seem like he has some stereotypical, you know, like childhood,
like an autism thing, right? Like he's obsessed with shapes or building something or you know a specific kind of structure or whatever it is. And Fred Savage goes over and he's just like, oh, he's stacking stuff. It means he's not better. And he just fucking knocks over all these popcorn boxes that he's been stacking up, like a savage. Like a Fred Savage. I'm really proud of that.
He builds things and he just bashes his little building to you. It's just awful. So. Really mean. Oh my God. This right here.
So in the to set this up, because this took a little bit of parsing out to understand what the fuck they were even talking about.
I still don't understand. I don't know what.
In the previous scene, apparently the reason that Jimmy walks out without challenging Lucas is because Corey says about, you know, he says his, you know, the most famous line in the movie, I love the power glove, it's so bad.
Lucas says that.
Corey says, well, you better keep your power gloves off her.
Right.
Kind of jokingly and shittily, like, what a dumb shit thing to say. And Jimmy walks out. And then they discover in this scene. And doesn't play Lucas. And they discover in this scene that apparently Jimmy is jealous of Haley.
And I'm not sure what he's jealous of. Is he jealous of his brother macking on that? Or is he jealous of Haley getting between him and his brother?
Well, she reaches out to him and he like pulls away. And okay, we present to you a dramatic reading of the scene. I want you to try to forget the context and try to understand what this means without any of the context. We probably shouldn't have set it up for you, but here you go. You start. You're Haley. I'm what's his name? Corey. Fred Savage.
That wasn't nothing. It's me, Corey. That's what it is. He's jealous.
Jealous over you?
Jeez, Corey, you're so thick. You're all he's got. Don't you understand that?
You're crazy. He doesn't even figure that way.
Well, what if he does? What if you do?
Do what?
You know what? It ain't like I need you weasels, you know, and you don't have to be acting like you need me.
What's the matter with you? That's a line. Like, I feel like at some point, Corey is actually confused.
He's actually do what?
It's like, he doesn't even figure that way. And what if he does? And what if you do? Do what?
Like, there are multiple ways that it could have been delivered that would have been more appropriate.
Would have made more sense.
The do what? Like, as in, I don't understand what do is referring to anymore. That would have worked. Also, do what?
Do what? I like these backwoods teenagers that drive around in a truck with nothing better to do than hunt down children, steal their $27 mm-hmm. and their baseball caps and drive away.
Yep. Mm-hmm. Like I said, everyone in this movie, right?
Well, the older they get, the shittier they become. Mm-hmm. That's this universe. That's what happens in this universe. And here's the info dump scene. This is the grand scene of exposition.
Let's look at how old Jimmy looks in these scenes. Fred Savage.
We're 45 minutes into this movie. I know. Look at these pictures. This was taken like 2 weeks ago.
Uh-huh. These pictures were taken about 2 weeks ago. Let's think about the implications of that. Well, first we need to understand what the pictures are. What are the pictures, Dustin? What was in Jimmy's lunchbox?
The in Jimmy's lunchbox were pictures and notes and letters and a shoe of his dead twin sister,
the
Jennifer.
Shoe is kind of
the shoe is weird. The shoe is going too far. I have to assume that there's a foot in it. So I just have to assume that. And of course, in classic fashion for this movie, two scenes ago or so, Christian Slater starts talking about Jennifer, and the audience is like,
"Oh yeah, that's right,
Jennifer. Who's Jennifer? Jennifer?" And then two scenes later, Jennifer was Jimmy's twin sister who died in. And they say this, like he goes into explicit detail about how they were down at the river. And it's kind of a callback from the beginning because the mother gets mad when the dad's like, oh, he could walk off and he could go down the highway or down to the river. And she's like, no.
No.
He never goes to the river.
Doesn't go to the river.
He would never go to the river.
And by that point, you already realize how bad the writing is and you're just like, fuck it.
Fuck
like,
it. I'm not even paying attention. Because like, if I try, okay. I'm going to have an aneurysm. So we discover in this scene, it is exposed to us through Fred Savage, that Jimmy's twin sister, they were down by the river.
I guess it was only Jimmy and Jennifer.
Jimmy and Jennifer were down by the river by themselves, I guess, because parents in this universe, right? And she falls in the river and can't swim, and Jimmy's too afraid to help her, but she doesn't float upriver. She just stays there and drowns in 3 feet of water right in front of Jimmy.
Mm-hmm, right.
And he explains all of this in vivid detail.
And I'm thinking, where did we get this information? Because Jimmy certainly didn't say anything. I mean, I can assume he doesn't talk.
And he's explaining all of this to Haley while Jimmy's sitting right behind them, as though Jimmy's not in the room.
But I'm really wondering, like, how everyone knows that, like, Jennifer didn't float downstream or anything like that. How they know that she died right. Because that's the kind of stuff that comes out when you're, like, in your mid-20s in a creative nonfiction class and you're writing about, you know, the death of your sister. And you write about, like, those little minuscule details of, actually, she didn't even float down the river. She was right in front of it. Like, that kind of thing. And I'm thinking, this little kid didn't recognize anything like that.
Yeah, no shit.
And if someone else was there to see that happening, then why didn't they go in the 3 feet of water and save her?
Sure.
Right? No? But more importantly, because this is the much more importantly thing here, is that these pictures were taken like you said, could have been 2 weeks ago.
Could have been 2 weeks ago. No one's any younger.
And at most, with the way that kids age, at most a year ago. At tops, yeah, right?
Right.
So we have a kid, Jimmy, who's acting strange after the death of his twin sister. The death of his twin sister right in front of him.
I mean, this, and keep this in mind, this is a film that encourages you to go back and think about the things that have been said before, because it's setting up stuff without context to make itself seem deep or well-written.
Right, it's that writing technique
intentionally
that they
like obtuse and confusing for no fucking reason. Let's go back. Let's examine the choices of these adults at the beginning of this film with the information that we know now, right? Jimmy is grieving. He is grieving for the death of his twin sister.
That might have happened 2 weeks ago.
That could have happened 2 weeks ago, but let's just assume it didn't.
And it's not just the death of his twin sister either. Recall, in the photo we just saw, which could have been 2 weeks ago, at most a year, Mom is with the family, with the whole family.
Yeah. Oh,
she
yeah.
is not yet divorced.
Right.
So within this year, Jimmy watched his twin sister die in front of him, and then Mom got a divorce, and a new man moved into his house.
Right. All of this happened within a very short amount of time, we have to assume.
And though he's supposed to be 80, looks like he's about 6.
Right.
So you imagine all this happening to a 6-year-old within 6 months or a year?
So their plan for this obviously traumatized child, this obvious child that needs help, who is grieving terribly, and these things are happening super fast in his life, and he doesn't have any control over them, they decide to put him in a home.
Right. Well, and the mom lets the stepfather, who's been around for, we can presume, about 3 months,
right,
bully her into putting her child
they've been married 2 weeks
into a home. And there's no repercussions for this evil stepdad either.
No.
Because
none
Putnam
whatsoever.
The evil kid catcher is so much worse that we just forget about evil
we
stepdad.
We forget about how shitty stepdad is.
Because he's really nasty to her in the first scene. And then he's even nastier in that second scene where he's like, you know, screw Corey. And I'm not going to get him too.
It's probably a good thing that the movie stayed away from autism, like as a word, or as trying to explain what's quote unquote wrong with Jimmy, because they'd be stepping in a big old shit pile of
there's a reason for autism.
Trauma causes autism.
Yeah.
So just.
Right. But I mean, they're still playing this card, right? Tragedy causes you to become a savant.
Oh, yeah. And they are kind of doing that because it is, yeah.
Because he is specifically like, this isn't like kids just got a good eye or whatever.
They're
he's
walking
like
that,
ridiculously
yeah, they're,
good.
They're definitely walking that really, really shitty line of he's been traumatized and he's become autistic, which makes him a savant at video games.
Right. That's exactly what this movie is doing.
I've got news for you. Trauma causes autism about as much as vaccinations do.
It's true.
Which is none. Spoilers for real life.
Spoilers for reality. Yeah, but that is really, like, once I had this revelation, you know, where I realized, oh my God, within 6 months, this kid has gone through the death of a sibling in front of his eyes, a divorce and a remarriage. And that's why he's not talking. God, the kid may not talk for another fucking 4 years or something, and you can still blame it all on that.
But at least the story of the horrifying accidental family death in Gremlins was maybe supposed to be funny. Like in that ironic way where Phoebe Cates is telling the story about how her dad dressed up as Santa and got stuck in the chimney and broke his neck and died on Christmas Eve and shit like that. And you're like, that's fucked up. How hilarious. But in this movie, they play it totally straight.
Oh, yeah. Well, I mean, I don't know if you could make
kid
death funny.
I don't know if you could play kid death funny, but yeah. Anyway.
But then, like, so many of the comments after you realize what's actually wrong with Jimmy, so many of the comments are so much worse. Like, right after that, pretty soon, Putnam is showing pictures of the kids around to try and find him. And he points at a picture of Jimmy and says, this one's a mental case.
Yeah.
And I'm like, whoa, no,
yeah, holy
man.
Holy shit, we don't say that. I mean,
you shouldn't say it no matter what.
Yeah, no shit. And look at this child labor going on. What is this?
You sure that's child?
watch her when she turns around. He's buying snacks from her.
Okay, yeah, it's a child.
That's a child. That looks like a child to me. He just bought snacks from a child dressed up in a cocktail waitress outfit, serving snacks in a arcade.
Well, you know, in Reno, right?
When in Reno.
When in Reno, child labor. But yeah, so you probably just shouldn't make fun of anyone who's handicapped. That's probably not the best thing to do with your dialogue in a movie.
Mm-hmm.
However,
Mega Man, yay!
This kid is not handicapped. This kid has no disabilities. This child is grieving from the death of his sister.
Yes.
Which might have happened 2 weeks ago.
Right.
So calling him a mental case because of that and all the other horrible things that they call him throughout this movie is pretty outrageous.
Yep.
Also, by the way, right now we are living off of $390 in this movie. Is that correct?
I don't know.
Well, yeah, that's what they're
$390. What did you account for the money that was stolen from them by the farmers?
No, this is after Spanky.
They've been, right, because Spanky. All right, that's right. Spanky the truck driver that Haley knows.
And they did the same thing. She mentioned Spanky's name, and then we had the scene in the casino where this guy Spanky.
Like, oh, it's Spanky. Good old Spanky.
And so we've got him gambling for them, and I guess he's supposed to be really stupid, so she gives him $10 after he wins $400.
Right.
So the kids have $390.
She's from Reno, as she says, which makes her a child gambling prodigy, because that makes perfect fucking
sense.
Oh,
yeah. She definitely is in the casinos all the time.
Oh, she's... She's like calling these plays and stuff, like, you know, what he's going to do with the dice. I think he's playing craps.
She can't even see the table.
She can't see the table, and she's calling these plays he's going to make with the dice on the board and telling him to, you know, call hard eights and stuff like that. And he calls a hard eight, and the dice roll, and they just disappear off the screen, and they're like, it's a hard eight. Like, they couldn't afford enough film to roll on the dice long enough to show it rolling eight. I mean, come on. Got Nintendo money here. Let's show a little bit of it off.
But yeah, so they are living in a hotel. I think they have 3 days. I think she said they have 3 days before the tournament. And he's got to become a master of every single 97 games in 3 days and learn all the tricks. And so they're living in a hotel, for one thing, in Reno. And it's mm-hmm. a classy looking hotel. Like mm-hmm. they've got a pool. They've got a pretty nice looking room, a big old bed.
Hotels are cheap in casino towns.
Oh, are they? I've never been to a casino town, so.
They're cheap because you spend all your money on the casino.
Okay. Well, whatever.
They want to get you there.
They're in a hotel. They're in the casino playing games all the time, which also costs money. We see them drinking drinks and eating food, which also costs money. And then...
All to Paul Carrick's I Live by the Groove.
And then... We see the Nintendo Gameplay Counselor, which you looked up the cost on that, right? She starts calling them.
Yeah, the Nintendo Power Line was a thing that existed that you could call Nintendo and they would help you get through a game if you were stuck. And it cost a whopping $1.50 per minute.
Damn.
Yeah.
Damn.
I read somewhere that before they closed shop, it got up to like $2 per minute maybe.
Man.
Yeah.
So, this is in 89.
Yep.
So
that's $1.50 per minute in 89 money.
Yeah. So she's calling them to, as I said, learn all the tricks and master every 97 games. And she starts off with, "Let's start with Simon's Quest." So we can assume, and by their whole montage, it was another montage, a training montage. Mm-hmm. We can assume that she's spending a lot of time on the phone with them.
Oh, yeah.
Because we see him getting out binder after binder after binder. We see her on the phone with him at the pool. We see her on the phone with him in the hotel. So I did math with a calculator, because that's the only way I can do math. And if that the $390, if it was not spent on the hotel that we saw and the food and the casino playing... then that would be 260 minutes of time with the counselor, which is 4.3 hours.
I'm glad you're doing the math on this.
I'm just letting you know that there's no way that their $390 got them past the first day.
So, I mean, they should be dead.
They should be dead.
Let's be real. They should be as dead.
They are in Reno by themselves.
As Jimmy's twin sister.
Yeah, it's true.
Drowned in 3 feet of water. Oh, God. They didn't even float upstream, downstream, whichever way it goes. Fuck it. So, of course, I mean, this movie is at least, if it's one thing, it's consistent. We've got Beau Bridges and Christian Slater bullying teenagers when they see a hat of his landscaping service on the head of the teenager who stole it from Jimmy, who is at least mentally traumatized young man. So we've got adults now bullying teenagers, being like, where'd you get that hat? Huh? Would you gonna tell me where you got that cat? Yeah, where'd you get that cat?
Tell me where you got that cat.
What are you doing with that cat there? And they find out where they're going. They're going to Los Angeles because Lucas is there, of course, and he's just like, I'll tell you where they're going. And he shows them the spread of the video Armageddon competition that they're going out to. But yeah, I mean, no surprise there. Adults bullying children, and now they're. And Putnam has their car towed. He has their truck towed away, mm-hmm. which at this point, it's just like, you're in like legal territory. You're in like,
I mean, you were in legal territory before, when he was slashing your tires.
But this is like lawsuit land. You are visiting lawsuit land right now and you're in big fucking trouble. But yeah, he stole the truck. He had that truck stolen and they started scrapping it and taking it apart. And then we've got a weird shot by the pool that we just saw of, I think we just saw it before, maybe.
Oh yeah. The random close-up of the girl in skippy clothing.
Yeah.
Followed by the random close-up of the old man balls and ass crack in your face.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yeah. I almost said something. I was about like, it's you're getting a little male gazy there. Or is this the scene?
Oh, maybe this is the scene. Oh yeah. Here we go.
Look at that. See?
It's kind of like wedged up her ass a little bit.
I was going to say it's a little male gazy, but then we cut to old guy in a Speedo and it just kind of lingered. I mean, we're on this shot far longer than we are the other. And look at that. Oh, uh-huh. My goodness. Beautiful. That's a sight to behold. But yeah, so the movie's like, yeah, you like that? Well, how about this?
How about enjoy? Yeah, we missed another weird... we also missed the first writing in the whole movie, which was...
When they see the hat.
When they see the hat on...
Teenagers steal the hat from the mentally handicapped boy, and then the parents, the Christian Slater and Beau Bridges, see the hat that is of his landscaping company and are like, oh man, it's my landscaping company. Of course, he knows where my boy is, probably.
Where's the stuff on his shirt? He just got stuff spilled all over his shirt.
Oh, did he?
Yeah.
I guess he did. He's got a fresh shirt.
He's got a fresh black shirt with the little...
And a bolo tie in his car ready to go. Oh, shit. We're about to have probably the worst shit in this entire movie.
Mm-hmm. Yep. Here we go.
Where they see Putnam... capture Jimmy and pick him up inside the arcade, and the first thing that Jenny Lewis thinks to do is scream and say, he touched my breast.
Yep. And the cops just hut, 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 hut.
They're just like, no questions asked, no questions asked. He touched her breast. That's against the law. Hup, 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 hup. Take him away. Take him away. Take him to jail. Take him to jail.
They just pick him up.
They just pick him up and carry him off. And it's like, easy.
Well, it's like the director was like, we need to get him out of the scene somehow. We've got to move on to the, we've got to get him out of the scene. Okay, well, we're just going to pick him up and carry him out. It's fine.
But
it's
holy fine. Shit. False rape accusations in a kid's film. Yep. Also, that the sign on that taxi said, what was it? 5 or less ride for the price of 1. How do you fit more than 5 in a sedan? What is that about?
I don't know.
People in the trunk or something?
Maybe it happens a lot.
On a taxi. That was weird. But anyway, yeah, that's straight up what that is. That's, you know. Now, it's not exactly rape, but it's basically, you know, the equivalent of a false rape accusation by a woman, by a female character. And the cops just drag him away, no questions asked. This was written by a person, a person that believes that that's how shit works in the real world.
Right. Oh, yeah. I mean, that's what us women do when we aren't sure how to get out of situations. You know, we just accuse someone of course, touching our
breasts. Beau Bridges is addicted to the Nintendo now, and he's just pulling cords randomly away from the TV.
I think he's going to miss some of that.
He's going to miss that RF adapter when he...
he just yanks some stuff out, and he's just like, oh, that's enough.
When they land next to the next TV that they land next to. I do like how, this is one detail that only nerds like me would care about, but I do like how they represent the Nintendo line, like the Nintendo call center line, because at all of, just about, not all of the desks, but at almost all of the desks, the people are playing the games with like BVMs, which are broadcast quality professional monitors, like the best picture quality that you can possibly get out of a CRT. And I think that's fucking cool. It's like, oh, holy shit, yeah, they're playing games the way they're meant to be played. They're seeing them the way they're meant to be seen. I don't know. I just thought that was pretty neat.
It is cool. So we went from he touched my breast to this next scene here where Haley is talking about her family being in dire straits because mom was a gambler. And... Fred, Corey, is going to say, it's like the adventures of Link. He has to find Zelda. You have to find a house. Referring to how she wants to go to the tournament because she wants to split that money with the boys so that she can buy a house for her and her father.
Yeah, what kind of house are you going to buy for $25,000?
I mean, that's if they split the money in half, and they really should split it three ways.
Is it $50,000 or is it $500,000?
Oh, I thought it was only
$50,000. I think it's only $50,000.
I thought it was only $50,000. Because I'm pretty sure, like, professional gaming tournaments today, even like $200,000 or something, is pretty incredible. So anyways, so he says to her, it's like the adventures of Link. He has to find Zelda. You have to find a house, because I guess we just had to fit a game joke in there somewhere in this whole movie. Yeah. And she says, boy, is that sexist. And he says, it's not sexist, it's romantic.
First of all, it doesn't make sense.
Right,
the analogy doesn't make sense. You have to find a house. It's like Zelda. He has to find the princess. You have to find a house, which is a stupid analogy in the first place. And then to say that that's sexist, is she referring to Zelda or the house? I would assume Zelda, which is obviously like...
But I don't think so. I think she's referring to the fact that that finding a house is a female thing?
I don't know about that. I think she's referring to the damsel in distress in Zelda, but that's not clear. What is clear is that we have to have a character claim that something is sexist so that the male character can say, that's not sexist, it's romantic.
Right.
Because that's something that the screenwriter has likely said in his life.
Oh, yeah, I'm sure. I mean, she is that crazy, angry, strong-willed, hyper-feminist who uses rape accusations to her benefit and who thinks everything is sexist when it isn't sexist.
Right. Oh, and that's followed up by probably the best moment that kind of rounds out. I mean, I think that more than anything, this screenplay develops the writer itself as character more than anyone else in the movie. And that is when he leans in for a kiss. And it's a no-go because she's not Winnie fucking Cooper. I'm sorry, your moves have no power here, Fred Savage. And she refuses him a kiss and says, no way, there's no way I'm kissing a boy. And he says, a girl maybe, or something like that. Like straight up.
You turned me down.
If you turned me down, you must be gay.
You must be gay.
Challenging her to kiss him. And then she kisses him. And he gets his way.
Yeah.
What the motherfuck?
And we're about to follow this scene up with she calls all that Jimmy just got kidnapped by the kid catcher.
The kid. I like how you pause there. Not rapist.
And Jimmy just got kidnapped. And so to get him back, Haley calls all her trucker friends, like Spanky, and she gets them to block him in the middle of the road because They're going to come out of their truck screaming that he touched her breast. So she calls the trucker friends to tell them that this guy touched her, to again lie.
Oh, yeah,
and tell
she takes to the next level. The shot right here was our hint. We only had one person correctly guess it, and that was Eric Wallace on Facebook. And the only thing he wants to plug is his own awesomosity.
Okay.
He wants everyone to know how awesome he is.
He's pretty awesome. So
good on
plugged. But yeah, so like this is the moment right here. But Spanky's gonna get out of the car and be like, "You touched her breasts," or whatever. And it's like, whoa, so we just did it again.
Oh, they double down on it.
Yeah.
They double down on the false rape accusation. Or the false breast touching accusation.
Yep.
But let's be real about what it is.
This girl who is a lesbian if she doesn't kiss Fred Savage, and who thinks things are sexist when they're not sexist.
When they're actually romantic.
Right. They're actually romantic. And I'm not saying, I don't think what Fred Savage said was sexist either. I think it was fucking confusing.
like most of the movie, really.
Like most of the writing.
Like I said, if this movie is anything, it's consistent. Brought to you by Pepsi-Cola and 7-Eleven in association with Slurpee.
But I understand the meaning behind it, which is that he was saying it's not sexist. It's not sexist when I call you hot at work. It's romantic. I'm complimenting you. I'm telling you you're beautiful. It's romantic.
I mean, he must be just an angry fucking dude, bro.
That's the only thing I can think.
His name is David Chisholm, and I looked at his body of work, and nothing else he's done rang a bell. Like a lot of little TV movies. I don't think he's done anything since like 1997 or something like that.
I mean, and you know, it's really easy for us to sit here and talk trash about people who exist in like another plane of existence.
Okay, 99. He's done TV movies and he's done like single episodes of some shows and mostly TV movies, it looks like. And he's done a little bit of series work. So, I mean, like he just hasn't worked a whole lot. Like he doesn't have a whole lot of credits on IMDb. And yeah, of course, it is easy and kind of, I guess, on some level, cowardly to sit, you know, from behind our mighty microphones and say, oh, this guy is this or this guy is that. I kind of wish he had a more well-known body of work so we could actually examine him as a screenwriter, because that shit that comes through, like
right,
that shit
yeah.
that you can actually...
You see again and again, it
exactly,
comes up, right?
Exactly.
But anyway. Oh, it's Grumpy from Once Upon a Time.
Yes, it is. He's the same guy from...
The Pirates movies,
the Hello Puppet, that dude. What is his name? I have it written down. Oh, Lee Ehrenberg. That's right.
We
need to calm down a little bit. He was like, the prelims are Ninja Gaiden. Hi! Calm down. Good to see you, though, Lee Ehrenberg.
You're
kind of a cool
actor. We also missed another really unnecessary line. The Putnam was on the phone with somebody, and he was... clearly talking to someone trying to get himself out of trouble for the accusations. And he's on the phone and he says, I touched her breast. She doesn't have any breasts.
I mean, she does, number one. Number two, that's not a funny line.
No. Mm-mm. It's not. Somebody thought that was funny.
David
Chisholm. Multiple people thought that was funny.
Oh, yeah.
Because it passed through.
It went down the line.
That's funny. Young girls don't have fully developed breasts yet.
There is one name on this screenplay, one and only one, and it's David Chisholm.
So isn't it funny? Isn't it funny when prepubescent girls have very small breasts?
It's even funnier when they take fashion advice from Barney the Dinosaur.
Yeah, she is doing that here.
So this movie is also brought to you by Universal Studio in association with Slurpee and 7-Eleven and Pepsi-Cola, Sinclair Oil Corporation,
Hostess
Snacks, the Dairy Queen, the goddamn Dairy Queen,
Nintendo.
And of course Nintendo. I mean, there's definitely more.
There's definitely more.
Like I think there was an advertisement for Tom Petty's new album on the side of one of the arcade cabinets, and yeah.
Tom Petty threw in some money on this.
His record company did, I guess. I don't know. So we are in the last chunk of the movie. There at Video Armageddon inside Universal Studio Hollywood, I guess. Universal Studios Hollywood. We're going to get some nice little cameo by Mr. Tobey Maguire coming up here soon. Oh my God, this announcer dude.
Oh yeah. He is just too intense.
Dude, this announcer, I mean, he's got this weird raspy voice and he shouts everything and he doesn't have a microphone. He just seems like, he seems like his character should be like a guy that used to have a crippling cocaine addiction before he turned, of course, to motivational speaking about his cocaine addiction. And he always, always refuses a microphone at speaking engagements without ever seeing the size of the venue or of the audience that he's going to be presenting.
Just a trait.
And someone saw him and they were like, well, we need an announcer for Video Armageddon, and he's probably cheap, so...
We don't even got to mic him.
We don't even have to mic him. Like, just let him go. Like, he'll just scream his heart out.
Don't even give him a script. It's just fine. Just let him make it up.
It kind of seems like that's exactly what he's doing.
Oh, yeah.
Terrible in this. He's terrible.
And what's up with this, the way this tournament... I mean... I have been to a few tournaments in my day of varying types of competitions.
Yeah.
I've never been to one of this size with this much money at stake where you can just walk in and play one round of one thing and then you're in the top three.
And that's it. Finalist. Straight up.
Finalist. I mean, we know there are at least hundreds of kids here.
I mean,
who are in the competition.
Nintendo used to have actual like tournaments. And I think that they restarted them last year for the first time in like 20 years or something.
That's
like that.
That's awesome.
Which is very cool. But probably the most famous one is Nintendo World Championships 1990, because that was the year that they produced the Nintendo World Championships NES cart, which came in a gold variant for the winners. Actually, the gold variant was a send-in offer from Nintendo Power, and they only made however many of those. And then if you actually competed and you were like in the top, maybe 100, top 100 in the actual competition, you got a gray cart of Nintendo World Championships 1990 that has like four games on it, like four short version, like tournament versions of games. And it's one of the most valuable carts that you can own now. Like every once in a while, one will go up on eBay and it'll sell for several thousand dollars or whatever. The gray ones are worth more than the gold ones, I think. Is that right? No, I think there were fewer gold ones. So the gold ones are worth more. And I think that the most anyone's ever gotten for it was like maybe $10,000.
That's a lot of money.
I'm not 100% sure on that. I think it's like 10 grand though. But yeah. This announcer dude is just an endless source.
And he
source
runs
of
off the stage.
Yeah, just runs
full force.
And
runs.
Everyone, there's no clapping. Mostly everyone's just looking around, like, "What just happened? What's going on? I don't understand." And he's like, "I gotta go do some cocaine. I fell off the wagon."
Yeah. So, also, why does the only girl who makes it into the top three? So the two boys, right, look normal or cool.
Normal or cool. Yeah, one is a normal looking
for
little 80, boy.
For an 89.
And the 89. Other one is, I mean, he's Lucas.
Right, but he's supposed to look cool. And the girl has to look like a nerd, like a classic nerd. And everyone's booing her and stuff from the start. It's kind of mean, right?
It is pretty fucking mean. It's
like they even give
mean.
Her the big round glasses and everything. And the people standing with her who are cheering her on are like much, much, much younger girls and stuff.
Look to the left. It's Tobey Maguire with a mullet.
Yeah, he does have a mullet.
He has no speaking lines, but look at him.
I can see him.
Look at little Spider-Man there.
So the Batemans are here. If you didn't know who they are, that's fine, because how can you follow this movie? But they are the parents of, it's the mom of Jimmy and Jennifer.
Dead Jennifer.
Jimmy. And her step-husband.
How do you get a step-husband?
I mean, this movie could find a way.
That sounds like a thing that might happen in polygamy, like in maybe Mormonism or something.
This movie could find a way. Like this movie could introduce another
character.
You
marry someone who already has a spouse, and that's how you get a step-spouse?
That's how you get a
right?
step-spouse.
Is that how that works?
I think so. She has the stepdad is her husband.
Oh my God. Like one of the people on this tram asks where their mother is, which is the first sensible thing anyone's asked.
That an adult has said the entire movie. But yeah, so she's there with her husband, Jimmy's mom, who also, though it doesn't feel like it, she was a mother to Corey and Nick for at least 8 years, so the movie says.
Yeah.
Though it doesn't feel like it. And the stepdad, who's been around for approximately 6 months, we can guess, they are here. And it looks like they're just here for vacation.
It kind of does.
Because they're in very casual summer clothes.
He's drinking out of a King Kong the Ride cup. Mm-hmm. And you're like, are you guys just hanging out while the Bounty Hunter finds your kid?
They're walking down a street with like Frankenstein, you know,
yeah,
nearby.
On their heels, yeah.
And it's just like, you're just hanging out, right? Because when they run into Putnam, they're both very surprised to see each other there. And that's like, what the hell were they doing? Like, we couldn't even come up with an excuse for why they're here in front of the video game tournament where their child is. We couldn't have even... I mean, I guess we can presume that Putnam told them that's where the kid would be, but they sure look damn casual to be searching for their missing child. Or, I'm sorry, her missing child.
Yeah.
Children.
This is not how a Universal Studios tour works. You don't just get on the tram that takes you around and it's like, and this is where they shot part of the thing for the blah, 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 and now you're on the King Kong ride.
That's how it works. What are you talking about?
I don't think that's how it works.
Here's the other thing that's great. The other thing that's great is that they are on the other side of town now. Mm-hmm. I mean, they have to be because we've seen them get on multiple trams at this point.
Right.
And they only have 15 minutes.
Town is a weird way to put it. The other side of the park.
Park.
They're in park. Universal it's Studios.
Right. Oh, I didn't realize they were in the theme park.
They're in the theme
okay.
park.
Okay. Well, that makes a lot more
sense
on
the King Kong
how
ride.
Everything looks now.
Yeah.
Anyways, the point is that they are on the other side of the park at this point. And they're about to go back. Wait, so the tournament's inside a
yes.
theme park?
Yes.
I'm sorry. I never got that.
Yes, which means you have to pay the $60 entrance fee to get into the park.
So how did the kids pay for that?
I don't know.
With their $390.
I don't know. I don't know.
There was so much money counting in this movie.
Oh my God,
so much. They made us very, very aware of how much money these children had at all times.
Lots of money counting.
Like, that was the only thing they were concerned about. They were like, you know, it doesn't matter whether or not it's logical for kids to, you know, hitchhike across the country without getting raped to death. But, you know.
Oh my God, Jesus.
But, you know, how much money they have.
I need to put this out here. Put this out there. There has been far too much talk of child rape. On this episode of Popcorn
there
Poops.
There has been. There has
There's been way too much.
I apologize.
And I'm kind of outside of my comfort zone right now.
Yeah, I think so too. You initiated most of it.
I did. And I apologize. But now we're at the point of no return. We're beyond the point of no
Look,
return.
No, realistically though, something terrible would happen to these children. Something awful would happen
yes.
to them.
I mean, and beyond being pulled out of a truck and having money stolen from them by farmers and left to die in the desert.
And beaten up by older kids.
And beaten up by older kids who also steal their money. And what else? What other terrible
things
happens to them?
I don't know. Lots of stuff. But the point is that the movie was so concerned with telling us how much money these children had to be like, well, the audience won't believe us unless they believe the kids have enough money. Like that was a point for this movie that we repeatedly came back to. So I didn't realize that I didn't realize the tournament was in the park, and that makes even less sense. But they definitely went across the park, and now they are magically the same building that the King Kong ride is in the same building as the tournament.
I think that's a really good question he asked. They just get inside this tiny, tiny elevator to escape Putnam.
Uh-huh.
And they're backstage at the video awards, and they just get inside and close the gate and push the button, and they just get lowered down in this cute, tiny elevator.
And it's slow, too.
And he's like, what the hell is that? And I'm like, right? What the hell was that?
But, I mean, that elevator was in the same room as the King Kong place. They went across the park and wound up at the same place.
You're asking for logic where there is none. Speaking of logic and things that don't make sense, the announcer says Video Armageddon will begin in T-minus 2 minutes.
And the clock says 1 minute.
And there's a clock counting down from 1 minute. No.
I told you, he's just making stuff up. And they're like, ah, that's good enough. Close enough. One's pretty close to two.
I don't know about you, but I'm running out of notes.
I mean, what else is there to talk about? I mean, the movie's really great. It's going really great so far.
I think the movie's going really well. I do.
We stole that joke.
That's probably my favorite joke from
I think so. MST3K. It's my favorite joke.
What episode is that? Final Sacrifice?
I think the movie's going really well.
So. I think that's from Final Sacrifice and like 15 minutes in.
It's not even. It's really early in
I
it.
I think it's like, I think it's Tom Servo just kind of apropos of nothing. He's just like, guys, I think the movie's going really well. That's fucking brilliant.
It's much better. You should go listen to that instead of this.
Don't tell him that. I kind of wish I had seen this in theaters because there.
You wish you had watched this another time?
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah, for sure. Because I feel like had I seen this to completion as a child, I only caught this in bits and pieces as a kid. Like, I knew it existed and I was like, oh, I really want to see that movie about the video games.
I did not.
And I caught existed. It, caught like parts of it on TV and was always like into it. And I've seen probably this last part of the movie half a dozen times or more. But I always wanted to watch the whole thing. But if you went to see it in theaters, some theaters would distribute issues of Pocket Power, which was a pocket-sized version of Nintendo Power magazine, which I was a subscriber to for like 10 years.
Yeah, it was in our house too.
I was a serious video head.
Video head. Is wizard a real term? I mean, I know, but
the,
like...
Well, whiz. Whiz is a term that's used like... The whiz, like... Not like the Wizard of Oz, the Wiz, but a Wiz being like someone who's naturally good at something.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I mean, I know that.
And then that kind of got co-opted by like the technology, like computer technology, culture as being a computer Wiz.
Okay, right, yeah.
So then like, I guess this movie kind of spins that into being if you're a wizard or a Wiz, you're like good with electronics and video games. I don't know.
I had never heard it before outside of this movie. So.
I haven't either. Like, I've never heard it in earnest outside of the context of this movie.
I didn't know maybe if you were a little boy playing video games in 89, if you had heard it then. So
this thing was a big deal. What they're doing right now, they're playing Super Mario Brothers 3, which is the first time anybody saw anything related to Super Mario Brothers 3. People went to see this movie and Super Mario Brothers 3 is revealed in the film and everyone in the audience shits their pants and goes, holy
at the same
fuck.
Time, it was disgusting.
It was so stinky. So stinky. Palpable stench everywhere. This was the whole world's first taste, or at least the United States, maybe the United States. I don't know about the whole world. But this was in the United States. This was our first taste of Super Mario. But I don't know if you just saw that, but there was a kid in the bottom right of the frame just then who's like pumping his fist like Arsenio style, just screaming, yeah, and looking directly into the camera.
No, I didn't see it.
I mean, directly for like a solid 10 seconds or however long the shot was. He's just looking right in the camera going, yeah.
That's his claim to fame right there.
That's it. That was
he shows that to all his friends when they come over
that
for
was
drinks.
That was his 15 minutes. I really hate, the thing I hate the most about this, especially in context of knowing that this was the first time anyone had seen Super Mario Brothers 3, is that they start playing the game and
immediately
start covering up the music with the shitty soundtrack.
Yep.
I'm sorry. Jenny Lewis's reaction shots are the worst of anyone.
Oh yeah, they're awful.
They keep cutting to the crowd and they'll cut to Jenny Lewis and she'll say stuff like, "Get the star, you gotta get the star." And then
that's the magic flute. Use it. It opens the warp.
Which is like, how did you know that? This is the first time anyone's ever seen this game. Right, so that one's not so bad. The worst one has already passed where she's like, oh no, you lost another guy. That means you have to start over at the beginning. Okay. Who are you talking to? what is the joke? There's a joke that some stand-up does. I think it's like, fuck me. I think it's a Dane Cook joke. God damn it.
Oh no.
But I think it was originally a Louis C.K.
Does that make it so much better for you?
Well, it does, and it calls out the shittiness of Dane Cook. But it's like the, you know, if you're at the concert, you say things that are really generic instead of being specific, like, I like the way that your music is making me feel right now, right? Because you're not really yelling it to them. They can't hear you, so you're just like, yeah, right? But what if you were more specific? And that's kind of what Jenny Lewis is in this scene. Right? That's the magic flute. Use it. Use it. It opens the warp. He can't hear you. Oh no, you lost another guy. That means you have to start over at the beginning.
Oh man.
This movie is a big old pile of duty. What was I talking about before? Anyway.
I don't know. We're done with the kid catcher now, with Putnam.
He's the bounty hunter. I mean, all it took was the terrible mom to be like, shut up. And he's like, okay.
And the movie was like, okay, we're done with that storyline. It's okay. We're not going to like resolve it for you or anything like that.
I don't know how Jimmy loses two guys. Like, he dies twice and still manages to win. How does that happen?
I don't know.
Because the only other one we see lose any lives is the girl.
I don't know. The way they calculate points in this is whatever. They just do their own thing. But I mean, I've heard that tournaments do that though. They calculate points differently than games do.
Yeah. Okay.
Yeah, so everybody's really happy Jimmy won. Oh man, I'm looking at Nick right now and I'm realizing, oh god, this host is terrifying.
I mean, he could have killed poor Maura with that flying clipboard stunt that he just pulled.
So when we looked at Nick, it reminded me there were some scenes with Nick and the dad in the hotel and stuff. And,
I'm sorry. Look at Jimmy. He's smiling. Aww. Doesn't this feel good? Like all sort of this, he won the grand prize and this will definitely bring his dead sister back.
Definitely. It definitely will.
Go ahead,
also, we've talked about child death a lot in this episode.
Child death and child rape. That's what you should take away from this episode.
From the wizard. So there was a scene where they were talking about him doing something, I don't know, hooking up to TVs to play video games or something when they were at rest stops or whatever. And he's like, it's not like I'm cutting tags off of mattresses. And I was just like, let's settle it. Let's settle it once and for all. What
does that mean? Because you've probably heard it. I don't know if the youngest generation that's like sentient now.
the singularity.
Right. I don't know if like, are they called digital natives? Because like, I don't think we're digital natives. I think we were born slightly before that. We are considered millennials, but like younger than us, the generation younger than us. Are they aware that there's just this universal understanding that if you cut tags off of mattresses, that's illegal or something like that?
Right, right. Because it says on there, like, punishable by whatever. It's against the law to...
Yeah, but it's a thing that pops up in, like, culture from time to time.
There are jokes and stuff.
Jokes in movies and stuff. But never you've never heard of anyone who actually was, you know, prosecuted.
Right. So I looked it up and... It's kind of one of those duh things. Like if you take more than 2 seconds to think about it, then and you're smarter than me.
Oh, okay.
And you.
Wow. Yeah, that doesn't take much.
Then, so it's not illegal for the customer, right? It's illegal for the seller to cut the mattress tag off.
Oh.
Because there's other stuff written on the mattress tag besides just don't cut this tag off. It's illegal. It says the stuff that the mattress is made out of.
So that you can't dispose of it a certain way, right?
No, it's like even more terrible about humanity than that, which is that back in the early 1900s, mattress makers were filling their mattresses with things like corn husks and old rags and newspapers and sawdust.
Okay.
Because they were cheapskates.
Cheapskates, yes.
So what the government did was make it illegal to cut off the mattress that says what is inside the mattress, unless by the consumer, so that people wouldn't wake up with sickness and bed bugs and all the other disgusting things that would happen from having horse hair inside your mattress
whatever. That makes sense.
So, yeah, now because we're stupid.
So it's an antiquated law. That is what it is.
I guess, but I guess also you want to know what's in your mattress. You want to know what it's made out of.
Yeah. Yeah, sure.
And usually now they often say shall not be removed except by the consumer because we're stupid.
Right.
So.
Okay.
So that's that.
That is kind of a duh thing. So we're at the very end of the movie.
Thank God.
Thank our loving and merciful Christ. And they have stopped. The whole reason that, and we've come to the whole reason that Jimmy wanted to go to California, and that was to come back and visit the Cabazon Dinosaurs, which is a roadside attraction, also featured in Pee-wee's Big Adventure. And between this movie and Pee-wee's Big Adventure, every child of the 80s knows about this place, whether or not they realize they know about this place. It is, I don't know if you saw it before, but Jimmy still has like ripped pieces of paper pinned to the back of his t-shirt.
Uh-huh. That's cute.
Did when he got out of the car. I don't know. Yeah, he does. Look at it.
That's a cute touch.
That's a really cute touch. Like where the...
That's
the,
like a reality,
the
yeah.
The competition number yeah. was, like it ripped off, but he still got the safety pins and like uh-huh. little pieces of paper attached on there. That's cute. But yeah. There was a picture, the picture that we saw earlier that was taken maybe 3 weeks ago
uh-huh.
with little...
At this place.
Jennifer, twin Jennifer alive and the
and
whole family.
Mom not and with mom a different not divorced.
Husband. was taken at this place, so we wanted to come back.
And so my whole thing is that this child has been saying California for maybe 6 months since his sister died.
Sure.
Year at tops.
That's generous. Yeah.
It's generous to say 6 months or a year at tops because the picture shows them looking exactly the same. So thus, all of the parents are such idiots. I mean, even more than we thought they were because none of them, I guess they take trips, they take family road trips to California all the time,
all
constantly.
All the damn time. Yeah.
Because otherwise, why would they not associate, oh, hey, that was that road trip we took 6 months ago to California before the sister died and he wants to go back there. But like, really? No one caught that? None of the adults in this movie?
I mean, the adults suck.
Why would he be saying California? Why does he even know the name of that state that we went to 6 months ago with his dead sister?
Like I wonder what he wants to do.
What is he talking about? Why does he have California in his mind?
Why is he saying that? I wonder why.
Kids don't remember things from 6 months ago.
They've got the memories of hamsters. We know this. It's child psychology.
Oh, man.
Though Jimmy is heavily traumatized, he likes to build things.
Heavily, that's right. They say heavily traumatized.
That was like one of the first things in the movie. The child psychologist says, though Jimmy is heavily traumatized, he has a fascination with buildings or something
because
like that.
Because that conjunction is appropriate there.
Right. The though is there to make make it seem more explanatory uh-huh. than exposition or expository rather. The problem is it doesn't make any fucking sense and context.
And also heavily traumatized.
Heavily traumatized.
Okay, this was your first draft. You need to go back and take out some of these adverbs, especially the ones that don't actually work.
Well, it's a redundant. It's like saying that something is decimated into 1,000 pieces. It's like that. You don't know. You can't do that. That's impossible.
Also, last thought about this movie was when they were on the back of a truck. Also, where did he get the truck?
I don't know.
Did they just put it back together for him?
They were scrapping the truck already when we saw it, and it looked a lot like his shitty brown truck from before.
Huh. Well, whatever. Jimmy and Haley and I'm struggling, Corey, were all sitting in the back of the truck driving off into the sunset, and Haley kisses Jimmy, and then she kisses Fred Savage, and then Jimmy kisses her, and then they all giggle, and I go, I'm just going to let you share me, guys, okay? Because that's what the writer wants, I guess.
This song that we're listening to now is a song called I Found My Way by Sally Dvorsky. Dvorsky. And some of the lyrics are, I'm standing on the edge of tomorrow, which I feel kind of ripped off that this song wasn't in the movie Edge of Tomorrow.
Or right.
Kill, Die, Kill, Repeat, die again.
Whatever title they tried to make work, and they
all you need is kill, die tomorrow, edge of again, starring Tom Cruise, which is actually a pretty fucking good movie if you haven't seen
yeah,
it.
Yeah.
But I think that this should have been the theme song of Edge of Tomorrow, but alas, it's buried here in the credits of The Wizard.
What a loss for humanity.
I think the credits already passed, but the catering on this film was done by Mario's Catering. Coincidence?
I think not.
I think not also. I'm out of notes. I'm 100% out of
notes. Oh, yeah. I'm 100% out. Can we just be done with this and never watch it again?
Do you think it worked on any level?
Do I think it worked on any level? I mean, it did for you, apparently, and for all the people on the internet who are super dedicated to this movie.
I think as just a basic lonely, cold skeleton of a road trip movie, it kind of does its thing.
As someone who has no... And I love retro games. Like, I'm
but it's terrible. Look, don't get me wrong. It's a terrible movie.
Yeah, it's terrible. If it weren't for the gaming aspect in this movie, I would never watch this in 100,000 years. With the gaming aspect, it was enough that I could get through it for the podcast. But I don't think I'll ever be watching this ever again, because I did not particularly enjoy it.
That will bring us to the end of another episode of the Popcorn Poops podcast, and also to the end of another wonderful theme month. Thus ends hashtag VG month. As always, you can find us on our website at popcornpoops.com. You can subscribe to us on iTunes or Stitcher. You can follow us on Twitter at Popcorn Poops. I am personally at Dusty Cram Cram.
I'm at J. Casper Kramer.
And of course, you can find us on iTunes, but Facebook. You can follow us on Facebook as well as Twitter to get updates about the show, including our weekly movie still identification game. We have a shop now, a merch shop, where you can buy currently t-shirts, buttons, tote bag. That's it. Go buy and enjoy our products.
Show
your poo pride. Or you can just donate to us. We have a donate button on the website if that's how you would like to show your poo pride. And also Audible. Go to audibletrial.com/popcornpoop. Sign up for a free trial. You get an audiobook that's yours to keep forever. No questions asked. You can't lose. Just go do it. It's easy, you dingus. Every week we like to highlight a friend of the show. We lovingly call these friends our poo pals. And this week we've got a new poo pal. This is the Film Pasture Podcast. Please stick around after the show for a few words from them. And if you are a podcaster, a webcomic artist, YouTuber, or any kind of content creator, and you're interested in becoming a poo pal and getting shout outs on our podcast and social media, contact us through Facebook, Twitter, or email to thepopcornpoops@gmail.com. We have a new theme and a new episode next week, of course, every week, new episode, but we have a new theme coming up for March. What are we doing?
We are doing hashtag world's finest month.
What the fuck is a world's finest?
In anticipation
<I'm sorry.
laughs> of Zack Snyder's newest movie, Batman v Superman, Dawn of Justice.
Oh, that world's finest. Okay.
We're doing a month of theatrical Batman and Superman films.
Excellent.
Next week, we're starting off with Joel Schumacher's 1997 schlock masterpiece, Batman and Robin.
Batman and Robin! Oh no! We're doing it! Holy shit.
We are.
All right, well, strap yourselves in, because it's going to be a wild ride. A whole month of Batman and Superman. I'm looking forward to this. This is in anticipation, celebration, perhaps a little bit of dread of the new Batman v Superman movie coming out. And this is how we show our love.
With Batman and Robin.
Batman and Robin. Here it comes. So until next time, take care.
Bye-bye.
We are the Popcorn Poops.
This is just great. Get a new car, breaks down the middle of nowhere. Now how am I supposed to get back home?
Oh my god, Kristen, is that you?
Oh my god, Vern, why are you in a field?
Oh, this is so great. I can't believe you drove all this way to join me on the Film Pasture.
Wait, you see, actually, I was on my way home, and...
This is so cool. We can have, like, fellow podcasters and critics come on to talk about various topics, like how to get followers and get free movie screeners and all.
I was wondering if maybe a mechanic is, like, close.
Oh, and we can each month we can have a roundtable discussion with various filmmakers talking about how movies are made. Oh, this is going to be so great. Thank you, Kristen.
Hi, do you know anyone that comes out this far? I'm in a...
Kristen! Are you trying to leave already?
Well, I mean, but... Of course not, Vern. I was just checking to see if there's a place that delivers food out here.
So, listen to The Film Pasture, available on iTunes, Podomatic, Stitcher Radio, and soon on YouTube.
What was the name of that cab company again?
What'd you say?
I was just asking Siri if, you know, they had bottles or cans.